So if you take a quantum particle and throw it at the wall, it will tunnel through the wall to the other side. That's quantum tunneling, right? Well, I used to think like that too, but then I heard about the 2025 Nobel Prize in Physics and I decided to truly understand this topic. And boy, was I wrong. In this video, we are going in depth on the quantum phenomena, which was the base of 2025 Nobel Prize in Physics. We are going to see how did we reach this weird conclusion, which does not even make any sense, and what kind of experiment we did which led to it, how we use this in our day-to-day life, and how even our sun cannot exist without it. And on the other side of the spectrum, we are also going to talk about another interesting effect of this quantum phenomena, which can literally annihilate the entire universe as we know it. So let's start with this simple problem I'm gonna throw at you. How do protons in a nucleus stick together? We know that same charge polarity repels each other. So in the nucleus of, let's say, an helium atom, both of the protons have same positive charge. So they should be repelling each other. They should basically throw each other off from the nucleus. Well, the answer is strong nuclear force. So when you study the strong nuclear force, it's a little bit more complex than your electromagnetic force and the gravity. The behavior is a little bit more complex. It is both attractive and repulsive, and that behavior is based on distance. Like, here's the graph, for example, to understand its behavior. However, when it comes to the distance which is relevant in an atom's nuclei, the strong nuclear force is really, really attractive. So attractive that it overcomes the electromagnetic repulsion of the protons. Okay, so we solved how protons stay in the nucleus together despite being of the same charge. But what does that have to do with quantum tunneling? Well, let's throw some radioactivity on this explanation, and suddenly it becomes paradoxical. So let's talk about alpha decay. Alpha decay is a type of radioactive decay in which two protons and two neutrons leave the nucleus. So first of all, what is a radioactive decay? Radioactive decay is basically when a heavier, more unstable nucleus breaks into two or more stable nuclei. But here is the interesting question. How did the alpha particle, which is basically two protons and two neutrons, how did that leave the nucleus? We just understood that in an atom's nucleus, the protons and the neutrons are basically held by a strong nuclear force. So when it comes to radioactivity, how does the particle leave the nucleus? Where did it get the energy from? Spoiler alert, the answer is quantum tunneling. But let's understand how does that actually work. Let's start with this simple experiment of throwing a ball in the air. So when you throw a ball in the air, you put some kinetic energy in the ball goes up to a certain height, stops there for a little bit, and then comes back down. When it comes back down, you see that it contains some energy. For example, when you catch the ball, you can feel that the ball has some energy, some kinetic energy. Where did the kinetic energy come from? Well, this is very simple, right? When you throw the ball up, you put the kinetic energy in the ball. As the ball was going up, that kinetic energy kind of was getting converted to potential energy against the gravitational field. And when that comes back down from that potential energy of the maximum height, all of that potential energy basically gets converted to the kinetic energy if we leave the air resistance, let's say. Now let's do a thought experiment. Imagine there is a ball or a particle stuck inside this well. Think of the height as the amount of energy it needs. So think of it like it is situated in some sort of potential field or whatever. And the ball is stuck here. In order to leave the well, it needs to first gain the amount of energy needed to cross this barrier, to gain this potential energy. And then when it leaves the well, it's going to have that potential energy converted into kinetic energy, just like we have our ball when we throw it vertically upward. So you see, you can basically measure the amount of energy needed to get out of that potential well by simply measuring the kinetic energy of the leaving ball or the particle. Okay, so that was the discussion in classical physics. But when it comes to quantum mechanics, there is a non-zero probability of that ball existing outside of the potential well, even without having the amount of energy. That's what we call quantum tunneling. It appears that the particle basically tunneled out of that potential well and got outside. However, there is no actual tunneling involved. It has basically something to do with Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So in short, Heisenberg uncertainty principle says that you cannot know the exact position and exact momentum of a particle at any given instant in time. And pair that with this highly successful quantum field theory, which says that every particle is basically an excitation in their respective field. For example, the electron is an excitation in an electron field, which permeates throughout the universe. And if you do the calculation and do this study on this potential well example, you'll find that the wave function basically has a non-zero probability outside this quantum well. So what does that mean? It simply means that when you are saying that your particle is in the well, remember that particles are not a point-like stuff in our universe. Particles are basically excitations in the field. And up until the moment you detect, observe, or measure a particle, it exists in a sort of superposition, which we call quantum superposition. So that means the particle has a very, very high probability of existing inside the well, but it also have a non-zero probability of existing just outside this potential well. And when you measure it, you might find there is a very low probability, but you might find the particle to simply be outside the potential well. It does not mean that particle tunneled through the well or went through the well or went over the well's barrier, nothing like that. But then you might ask, how do we know that the particle did not went over the wall? How do we know that it simply spawned outside the barrier rather than going up and then coming back down? Well, remember our example when we gave for the ball throwing up and then coming back down. When the particle crosses the barrier, it has some potential energy which you gave it in the first place to cross that barrier. At that peak height, it has this potential energy. When it goes back to a lower state, which exists outside the potential well, when it comes back here, it should have the right amount of kinetic energy, almost the exactly equal amount of kinetic energy, which it did in form of potential energy. Well, we measured that kinetic energy of alpha particles during an alpha decay, and turned out the alpha particle coming out of an alpha decay have nowhere close the amount of energy which is needs to cross the barrier. In fact, the kinetic energy of alpha particle is way, way less. So this is how we know for certain that the particle did not cross the barrier. The particle did not go over it. It's purely uncertainty that when we did the measurement, when we tried to observe the particle, we found the particle to be existing outside the potential well. And this is quantum tunneling. Despite the name says, there is no tunneling involved. It's pure uncertainty. Now, why are we studying it? Turned out that our sun can only exist because of quantum tunneling. Let me explain how. So if somebody asks you, how does the sun produces energy? You'll say nuclear fusion. But let me ask you, what is nuclear fusion at the very base of it? Well, the answer to that question is simply that you bring two smaller nuclei together and somehow they combine together and create a bigger nucleus. So what's the problem here? Okay, let's try to do that ourselves. You know that nucleus contains protons and protons have positive charge. So when you try to bring them together, you are going to feel a force. You may ask, what kind of force? Simple, electromagnetic force of repulsion. We all have studied Coulomb's law, right? The closer you bring the particles, the closer you bring the nuclei, the stronger the force will get. And it tries to repel. It won't let you bring the nucleus any closer. So how do you overcome this? Well, you need to give a lot of energy to the particles or to the nucleus or to the protons so that they can come closer. Well, what happens when they come closer? If you remember our talk on the strong nuclear force, that strong nuclear force depends heavily on distance. And when the protons come extremely close to each other, then the strong nuclear force takes over the electromagnetic repulsion. And then they can basically glued together as a single nucleus. So you need to provide enough energy to the protons or to the nucleus so that they can come together, and then the strong nuclear force can take over. How do you do that? Simple answer is temperature. Temperature is basically the average kinetic energy or average vibration of all the particles in a stuff, right? So when you start heating a stuff, the particles start vibrating. And that vibration intensity and frequency, whatever, increases with increase in temperature. When you do the calculation, turns out that the temperature needed to fuse two hydrogen nuclei in an helium nucleus is way higher than the temperature of our sun. So how does our sun then do the nuclear fusion? The answer is quantum tunneling. You can imagine both of the protons and imagine this Coulomb force, the repulsive Coulomb force, as a potential barrier, right? Technically, you need to give the amount of energy required to cross the barrier to go to the other side and then kind of combine with another nucleus. But as we said, our sun does not have high enough temperature for this energy barrier to be crossed by the particles. However, quantum tunneling is in effect here. So the hydrogen nuclei can find themselves sometime purely by uncertainty and purely by chance outside of that Coulomb barrier, Coulomb force barrier. And when they do so, this strong nuclear force then takes over the electromagnetic repulsion. And that's how you get the nuclear fusion in sun. Even though the probability is very, very small, but the amount, the number of particles in sun combined with even that small probability yields in good enough number of nuclear fusion so that our sun can generate energy. Now, that was on the positive side of the spectrum. We can also talk on something on the negative side of the spectrum. So let's talk about something called vacuum decay. That is also an effect which is due to this quantum phenomenon known as quantum tunneling. So in order to explain this, let's talk about Higgs field. Higgs field is a scalar field. It is basically give mass to this subatomic particles. So for example, electrons and quarks. Proton does not get all of its mass from this Higgs field because proton is not an elementary particle. Proton mass is basically a combination of mass from quarks, and majority of its mass comes from the gluons. Anyway, so right now the value of Higgs field is not zero, unlike other fields like electron, for example. Electron field has zero value, approx zero value everywhere in the universe. Not with the Higgs field. Higgs field has a non-zero value and that gives this mass. However, turns out that the Higgs field right now is in a local minima like this. And there are other at least one or more local minimas there. So for example, there can be another local minima or there can be a baseline zero value. However, in order to the value of Higgs field to drop down even more to another local minima or let's say to the zero baseline, it first needs to cross this barrier, this potential barrier. And as we just saw it needs that amount of energy. However, due to quantum tunneling, there is a non-zero probability of that happening without the energy. And when that happens, when the Higgs field reach, let's say, another local minima, all of the masses of our subatomic particles is gonna go down. Let's say there is no local minima and the Higgs field value goes back to zero, then everything will be massless. So what will be the effect? The effect will be catastrophic, right? The quarks will be lighter or will have zero mass, or the electrons will be lighter or will have zero mass. So that's basically gonna vaporize, or decay is the proper term. It will basically gonna be decay of the entire universe, and that is known as vacuum decay. Coming back to this Heisenberg uncertainty principle, there are a lot of myths around it as well. I briefly touched upon it in this video, but if you want an explanation with a little bit more depth, you can watch this video here.